Good evening, everyone. We'll call this meeting to order. It's 7 o'clock. It's Tuesday, November 24th, 2015. We're in the Sierra Room of the Community Center. It is a time, date, and place for the scheduled Carson City School District School Board meeting. Agenda item number one is, Dion, would you lead us in the flag salute?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Agenda item number two, adoption of the agenda as submitted.
So moved.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion, 2 seconds. Okay, Laurel. any input from the public on the agenda? Any changes, additions, deletions? Seeing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Okay. Okay, agenda item number three, superintendent's report.
Good evening. Thank you, Mr. President, members of the board. We have some very special guests with us this evening that I would like to make you aware of. I'd like to invite Coach Mike Alvarez, the coach of the boys' NIAA Division I state champion soccer team, to come forward.
Thank you, Mr. Stokes, members of the board. I am very pleased to be here. This is something that hasn't happened in 17 years. And from what I understand from the athletic department, it has been since 1994 that a team has won the regional championship and the state title all in 1 year. And I'd like to present to you your 2015 Division I boys soccer champion. You know, they were a great group of kids, and not because they won, but because of their heart. They were, if you will, the Rocky Balboa of the league. They weren't the biggest, they weren't the baddest, but they were resilient, and they had heart, and that's what mattered the most, and that's what earned them that position. But, it's a team effort, and, you know, with me, I have some incredible coaches from the community that have been with me the last couple years that we all work together. I have Frank Martinez, Chris Gracie, and Jorge Ortiz. Like I said, they have helped to mold and to develop these young men into incredible citizens. We hold them to a higher standard. I don't allow academic probation. We started that 2 years ago when I became head coach, and we had to refuse 10 players to try out. And this last year, we didn't have one single player. So I just want to thank you for this time to acknowledge their success in life. Thank you.
Hey, well, Mike. Hey, Coach. Yes, sir. You did a fabulous job. But could you have your have the players come up and introduce themselves?
I would love that, Ron. Thank you very much.
Gentlemen, if you come up single file, please. Introduce yourselves.
The first one up has the honor of carrying the state trophy, which we got on Saturday.
Before you start, Coach, I don't mean to interrupt, but if you guys want to take pictures, you can come back over here so you don't get the back of their heads.
Why don't you give your name and what position you played?
I'm Jose Sepulveda, and I play center mid.
I'm Victor Guardado, and I'm a goalie.
I'm Jonathan Garcia, and I'm a midfielder.
I'm Alejandro Gonzalez, and I'm a center mid.
I'm Abel Sanchez, and I play forward.
Scored 2 goals in the finals.
I'm Joshua Huss, and I play forward.
He was a German exchange student with us.
I'm Jonathan Lamone, and I play center mid.
Peter Garrett, and I play center defender.
Guillermo Perez Morris, and I play left mid.
Ernesto Lamas, and I play center mid.
I'm Christian Martinez, and I play right defender.
Rogelio Herrera, and I play striker.
I'm Brian Yamas, and I play left back.
Guillermo Hernandez, I play center mid.
Hi, Ms. Aldana, and I play right mid.
With the 4.0, by the way.
Efren Ramirez, and I play goalkeeper.
Oscar Ventura, and I play forward.
All right, now, how many seniors? Okay, juniors?
We actually have a very young team.
Sophomores? And freshmen. So you've got a lot of returning players. And the seniors, now going forward for next year, are you going to play college or going to college to play soccer? Well, I want to say, and I'm sure all the board members want to speak, but I know as a Carson City School District and for Carson City as a community, we're all, you know, extremely proud of what you did. You guys now are the leaders of this community for tomorrow. So you got to be very proud of that, and just keep it up, keep that winning attitude, and just keep it going. So.
I just wanted to say congratulations. I've coached soccer for a lot of years, and I know kind of what it takes to develop a team. You know, and skill's one thing, but to get that skill playing together is kind of how you win championships and whatnot. So, you know, congratulations not just for the win, but for the team effort. And, you know, I'm sure you had to stick by each other through the whole thing. So, well done.
And Mike, could you do one thing? Could you have your the three coaches you named, could they just come up?
Absolutely.
Okay, just again, just for the record, just tell us your name. And
okay. My name is George Ortiz, and I've been coaching some of these kids for their freshman year. And it's a great feeling to see them up there, so really proud.
Thank you.
My name is Chris Gracie. This is my second year with the team. Very proud. They worked very hard all season, and they truly earned it.
Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Coach Frank Martinez. I've coached these guys for 2 years, but half of these kids have been with me since they were five or six. It's been a pleasure and honor, and it was my goal to guide them so they could play high school and then future in college. And then this year, my goal was so that they would win state either this year or next year. We did it this year. It was actually, the goal was to win it next year. So guess what? We will repeat next year. That's our goal. Next year, I'm very proud of the boys, the coaches, especially for sticking with my values. My values were from when my son, Christian Martinez, since he was five, I've coached him. It was school first, discipline, honor, dignity, and winning will come. And I believe that's what got us there. And I thank Mike for helping me out, and George and Chris and the boys and the parents. Without the parents, we wouldn't be here. And without the parents, the boys would not be who they are. So, and this is just the beginning. With their help, with your help, this community will grow, and the future of soccer and the boys, it won't just be soccer, it'll be their academics will soar. So my goal is that from now on, half or most of them will play in college. So thank you very much.
Well, Mike and all of the coaches, thank you for what you've done in leading this group of fine young men. And again, you know, the students, the student athletes and the players, they're now the leaders of the community. So thank all of you very much for what you've done. Thank you.
How are you? Okay. My name is Donnie Garrett. I'm actually the father of Peter Garrett. And I wanted to announce to the boys that I'm kind of like the team cheerleader. That's why my voice is still strained from screaming so much during the games. We're very, very proud of these boys. And one big thing is they've earned everything that they get. So I've taken upon myself and my wife, Lynn, that we're going to put together a mandatory awards banquet for the whole team and your folks, that I've been going around the community getting donations and still working on them, that we're going to underwrite the whole thing so there's no expense to them, in conjunction with John Herzl over at Grandma Hattie's. And we're going to have a nice banquet dinner for you guys on December 6th, which is Sunday, at 4 o'clock in the afternoon. So it's a mandatory awards banquet for you. Okay.
Mr. Garrett, why don't you let people know, because it is filmed and stuff, let them know how they can contribute to that if they would like?
Well, I guess the best thing, they can get a hold of me on my cell phone, which is 443-7823. Either leave a message or I'll try to answer it when I can during hours. Anything would help a lot. Thank you.
Thank you.
Mr. President, members of the board, just one last thing, and that would be that there's no school tomorrow, obviously. I think that's a well-known fact, and I know folks are looking forward to having a few days off. And I would just remind you to keep an eye out for some of the school holiday programs that are going to be advertised, and Renee, I know, has already put together a list there for you, and ask that you consider maybe being able to attend those as you can. And wish you all happy Thanksgiving. Thank you.
Okay, moving on to agenda item number 4. Board reports, we'll start with Monica with Pioneer High.
Thank you, members of the board. The UNR School of Nursing students presented to the Pioneer High School students and staff. The nursing students surveyed and researched ways to assist Carson area youth regarding common teen health and wellness issues. Their presentation helped to shed light on the important issues that Pioneer students deal with daily. Pioneer student leadership, along with generosity of Pioneer High School staff, provided 29 Thanksgiving dinners to deserving Pioneer families. Rock Sport will take place on Friday, December 6th, and on December 8th at 5 to 6 p.m., Pioneer High School will host an open house for prospective students. Thank you. This concludes the activities, events, and announcements for Pioneer High School.
Thank you, Monica. Tommy?
Thank you, members of the board. So this past Saturday, our council attended what is called Western Regionals. It is where all the student councils from our region, which is pretty much from Carson City and Douglas up in the state of Nevada, get together, and it's pretty much just a big leadership party, which is a really cool thing. Unfortunately, I wasn't able to make it, so I had another one of our council members type up a little blurb about it. So this is what she said. She said, Western Regionals was a lot of fun. Comparing it to last year, it wasn't as much fun as it could have been. Our school is lacking in school spirit, and it showed in our council. In times we should have been cheering, there was socializing, and we were socializing with our own council. The JC groups were fun, which are kind of like little workshop groups. I came back with lots of ideas for our class. They also had a great guest speaker who has a great book and was very influential. We sent one workshop and four JCs to the conference, and the day went pretty well. And so that was what we did last Saturday, and unfortunately I wasn't able to go. And then also, I just want to say, our Carson High football team won the region championship, and they unfortunately last Friday they lost to Reed in the North championship. So, and that concludes my report.
Thank you, Tom. Steve? Dion?
Just a couple of announcements from Fremont. On the 3rd of December, the second grade is going to perform a winter concert, and that's at 7 p.m. The fifth graders are participating in the tree lighting on December 4th at the Capitol. And the leadership program is sponsoring a Toys for Tots bin at their school, and that will be out until the 14th of December for drop-offs.
And Stacy, Vice President of NASB.
I don't have any reports.
And Ryan? Laurel.
For Fritch, Mr. Brown wanted to make sure that we thanked all of the veterans who attended the Veterans Day Assembly. He said there were 54 veterans that attended it, including, I noted when they announced it, two World War II veterans, which was nice to have. And also last week's Watchdogs event was well attended, and if any persons are still interested in becoming a watchdog, please contact the Fritch office and they will forward your information on to the watchdog leader. And Monday of this week, the PTA hosted the Artist in Residence program. Sarah Billings was the chair who organized it and had local artists come in and teach each grade level, a different artist for each grade level, an art. I got to help out in the fifth, third, and kindergarten classrooms. The kindergartners did Van Gogh's Starry, Starry Night, which was pretty cool with the blue and black plate for kindergartners. Anyway, we're still working out the details on when there's going to be a showing of those for the students. And also next Friday is the Christmas tree lighting at the Capitol building, and all the fifth graders in Carson City Schools will be singing on the steps of the Capitol building. So that's a fun event to attend if you're able to.
Thank you, Laura. Joe?
Just one quick announcement for the high school. There's going to be a UN pilgrimage, so all juniors 16, 17 years of age are invited to apply. The students are going to get an all-expense-paid trip to New York to visit various sites as well as the UN. And again, it's open to all juniors 16 to 17. Applications are due December 11 by 2:30 in the afternoon, and you should submit them to the guidance office. And that concludes my report.
Okay, one quick announcement, and then there'll be a follow-up to this. And that is, at the NASB conference, that's the Nevada Association of School Boards, we had two of our nominees that received the awards for the year, and that was our friend of education, Mike Jackson, and our principal, Lee Conley, got the school administrator of the year. And in talking with Mr. Soaks, at our next meeting, December 9th, we're going to invite both of them to come with their trophies, and we will do the formal honor ceremony. But I want you to also know that this board also nominated four others. Renee Cortez was nominated, Steve Pedere, Robert Ma, and Lisa Saki-Koop. And I'm sure we'll be renominating them next year. So, anyway, with that, we'll see Lee and Mike at our next meeting, December 9th. Association reports. Seeing none. Public comments. Now is the time for any in the audience who would like to come forward and talk on any subject that is not on the agenda. And seeing none. Agenda item number 7, the informational update on McKinney-Vento students in the transition program in Carson City. Becky Sweetland.
Good evening, President, members of the board. Here I am again to give you an update on the students in transition program, and I have a little PowerPoint, and I will do this correctly. Definition, and I'm just going over the basics, just in case anybody has forgotten or doesn't know. What is the definition of a student in transition? That's anyone who lacks regular, fixed, or adequate nighttime housing. And that can mean they're doubled up with others, living in a hotel, motel, emergency transitional shelter, motor home, unaccompanied youths, foster care, awaiting foster care, and incarcerated parents. Now, the incarcerated parent isn't a living situation, obviously, but we track them because normally when a parent is incarcerated, the students or children are displaced temporarily, not to mention psychologically. That's kind of a lot to go through as well. So we just find out, do a little more research on them, and bring them in if it's appropriate. Immediate enrollment for the students in transition, and they are eligible to stay in their school of origin, which is the school they last attended when they were permanently housed, or the last school they were in when they were doubled up, or wherever they were. They're allowed to stay in their school. Every time a student changes or moves to a different school, they lose 4 to 6 months of their academic grounding. So we really do our best to keep them in their school of origin. We enroll them without birth certificates, immunization records, proof of residency, CUM file previous school records, and proof of guardianship. Pretty much they are in our schools within 24 to 48 hours as soon as we can get them a seat, and figure they're better off to be in our classrooms than out on the streets. So any of those additional records that need to be secured, I'm notified and I help with whatever I can help with, which is pretty much everything on that list. The population as of yesterday was 467 students. That's up by about 40, 45 from last year at this time. We ended last year with 610 students in our district, and then we had 3 from other districts who we also helped accommodate. Since 210, that is 149% increase in growth. So we're hoping that number goes down, but it's not looking too likely this year. And I apologize for this. I worked endlessly trying to get this larger, but I just finally gave up and figured hopefully you could see it, and I think you can. Current count is the actual count today or yesterday that are in those grades from pre-K through 12, so you can kind of get an idea. And the most popular or the highest populated grade level was first grade with 45 students. Our kindergarten population is huge this year. 39 is a very large number, and hopefully that won't be as large next year, but that's an indicator that our numbers are still growing. This is just a quick rundown, abbreviated the sites, Seeliger on down through Carson Middle. If anybody doesn't understand the acronym there, just let me know. So those are the totals, exited and current, as of yesterday. And then this is just an FYI for where most of our kids are in their situations, and most of them are doubled up, as you can see. Parent incarcerated is a pretty scary high number. We only started tracking that population 2 years ago, and that was through pretty much our office staff, teachers, and people who would hear about it on the news or see it on the radio or knew a friend who ended up being incarcerated that weekend or whatever the situation was. And as I mentioned already, it just means we need to follow up and check into the situation with the students. The services that we provide are academic support, and I know I mentioned last time I was here that I was working hard on getting the academic tracking up and active at the schools, and it is, I'm happy to say. We are on the OneDrive, so we have a shared drive. It's either the vice principals or a secretary or a counselor at each site who is responsible for updating the data, and then the principals, the VPs, and the people who are interested in viewing the data can at those school sites as well. Nutritional services, we get them free lunch, free meals right away. Within that day, as soon as they hit my desk, I notify nutrition, and they get them their meals. Transportation, to date, we've secured transportation to keep students in their school of origin for 49 possible transfers. So that number is huge, and we're working on improving that ability. If we had our own bus, that would be amazing, because then we could get kids to school more quickly and not have quite as much seat time on the bus. So that would be a goal for the future. I give away a lot of Jack bus passes to parents and students so they can get to school activities or extracurricular activities, whether it's the library or the swimming pool or some other sports-related or whatever-related activity, including the laundromat, which is not an activity but a necessity. So we do a lot of the adult and youth passes. School fee waivers. The schools are amazing at getting the fees waived. All it takes is an email. Once the kids are marked McKinney-Vento, then a chain email goes to all the relevant people who help waive those fees, including student body car fees, student body card fees, welding, all kinds of fees that students incur in high school especially. Can be hundreds of dollars. In the case where they are not waived and the school for some reason can't do it, we do have a nice donation account that a lot of the community has done an incredible job at building up, so I have quite a bit of money in that donation account. School supplies, lots of school supplies, lots of backpacks, standard student attire. We get polos, black and khaki pants, shoes, undies, hygiene, whatever the students need, we have on site, and that again is through the donation account. Credit recovery classes during the summer, caps and gowns, yearbooks for seniors, because they're so darn expensive. So we kind of had to narrow the scope on who we give the yearbooks to. Summer school referral services and Holiday with a Hero, which is coming up on December 16th, Wednesday the 16th at Walmart. The highlights of the program are academic tracking, the community referrals, the jacket drive, which is going on right now. And as a matter of fact, today I visited both of the middle schools and the high schools and dropped off close to 100 jackets and hoodies at those sites. The Carson City Fire Department is working on bringing the jackets in for the elementary schools, more than 200 jackets through their Project Warm. So on 12/9 at 9 o'clock, we will be delivering those jackets to all six of the elementary schools. And there are over 200 jackets there. So it's taken a little while to secure the jackets due to funding, but they will be dropped off on the 9th. As I already mentioned, those community donations. The next big activity we do, big fundraiser, and we do supply every single student and every McKinney student with new shoes. And that's pretty awesome. And these things go to the schools, and they're very confidentially dropped off. There's no, you know, we respect everybody's confidentiality, and some kids don't even, they want to go by the office and pick up the shoes and stuff them in their backpack on their way out the door. And whatever they want, we make work. So that's a pretty neat activity as well. Summer swim passes, we gave away more than 20. I think we gave away 29 last year. And again, the credit recovery. Our community collaborators are amazing, and we have each other on speed dial. And the newest one, our school-based health center, which just opened, as you all know, last month, right next door on the other side of my door in the same building. So the CDBG grant and all that good stuff paid off, and we are there. Ron Wood Family Resource Center, Boys and Girls Club in Nevada, Carson City Health and Human Services, FISH, Salvation Army, and Advocates to End Domestic Violence. Unfortunately, we are talking, advocates and I are talking about twice a week. So we have a lot of situations there, but we're able to take care of them. So that's a good thing. And that is my personal information. One other item I did start getting tracked just this year because I was asked about what is the number of families that we're serving. So out of the 647, 282 of them are families. So there aren't 467 families. There are 282 families with multiple kids in families. So that's kind of a nice figure to know. Did anybody have any questions?
Yes, Peggy, great program, and I know you work it with a lot of diligence. My curiosity, you've covered some of the high points. What's our challenges? What are we kind of issues you think we're looking at?
In serving this population?
Yes.
Well, the parents obviously in some cases have made poor choices. So I feel that connecting the parents with more parenting workshops would be helpful. And we do that with Ron Wood. But I really feel that there isn't a whole lot out there available to them. And it's hard to say if it was available, if they would attend. But I do know that parent workshops are well attended if the parents know that you care. I used to run the ESL at Empire at Night for 8 years. So I taught those adults in the evening. And at first it was slow to go, but after the first year, you know, word of mouth, parents came in, and really my classroom was full. So I think that more classes for parents to help educate them would be a good thing. And from my vantage point, transportation is always a struggle. And it's not uncommon. I just got back from the National Association for the Education of Young Children and Youth, and there were 1,200 attendees throughout the U.S., and that is pretty much the number one problem. People are trying to get their own buses and get the kids to school more quickly, which should take 20 minutes and it takes an hour. That's a little bit of a burnout. I would say those are the two main things.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
I just have a question on the transportation. Is that because we have buses that serve all of the schools here, and it seems like, I mean, my kids are on the bus, you know, they get on it fairly early. Is it because they can't work with our existing bus routes that transportation is a problem?
Right. Our bus routes are pretty much full to capacity. So whenever I'm referring one of my students to Cherie down in transportation, who is the director down there, she reroutes the route. So all of the kids on that bus are slightly affected by minutes or more in some cases. But honestly, in a dream world, I would love a McKinney-Vento bus. They're doing the best they can. I mean, transportation can't do any more than what they're doing. Yeah.
Okay. The referral process. How do you get to the kids? You know, it's probably the individual school. I think I read some about the individual schools referring, but have you got everyone, do you think?
No. No, there are many more out there. It's a difficult process to identify them, and now that we're online, which is a wonderful thing, it becomes even more of a challenge to identify them because they're going in and they're sitting at a computer, and in many cases with my families, they do need assistance, so that's when the conversation happens. So there is an area on the registration when they first start the application process that's very clear and asks them about their living situation, check yes to this. If they don't check that box, it won't lead to the next drop-down, which leads them to all the McKinney information. So that's where it's become a bit more challenging. But as you can tell by our numbers, it's just been a little more work for office staff and teachers and myself. And at the end of the year, I've started sending out a letter to all of our existing families just to notify them that if they are in a student in transition situation the following year, they need to go through the process again and apply, and it's not an automatic. We don't carry over any numbers. They all get cleared out in July. So we start with zero at the beginning of each year. So I think that has helped a lot.
Well, we've said it before. I mean, thank God for you. This is a wake-up call every year. It's not a good thing, but there's somebody here that cares and takes care of these kids. So anything else that we can do as a board to help you?
Well, I don't think so. I mean, you can always, if you're suspect that somebody may be a student in transition, you can always give me a call. My number's on the back of that brochure. And actually, this was a real helpful thing to create, which I did 3 years ago, and you all got a copy of it. One is elementary and one is middle high, and basically the difference is the eligibility for FAFSA going on to college and the other one. But on the back is all this, all these great speed dial contacts, including mine on the bottom. So this is a good talk sheet for people to have, too.
Additional questions, comments? Okay, we'll stay right there. I think you're next on the agenda with the policy.
Okay.
And that's agenda item number 8, discussion on newly proposed CCSD policy, first reading policy 255, McKinney-Vento students in transition. And Valerie and Peggy.
Good evening, President Sorzik, members of the board and senior administration. Valerie Dockery, director of grants and special projects, one of which is the McKinney-Vento program. McKinney-Vento is funded federally. The money that we receive to support these students comes through a competitive grant that we have been fortunate to receive every other year. Part of a large portion of that grant pays Peggy's salary, and the other portion is paid out of Title I. So that's how we're able to offer these services. And I really want to commend Peggy for all the hard work that she's done to support these kids, because we have probably one of the premier programs in the state to serve this population. I also want to thank transportation, because even though it is a really difficult task, because we're busing kids within across zones, and that's what makes the transportation difficult, our transportation department has worked really hard with us to make it possible for our children to go to school every day, and they go above and beyond every day to make sure that those kids come. So even though there are some challenges, they're working really hard with us, so we appreciate everything they're doing. So in terms of having a quality program in the district, we thought it would be important, and we've been thinking about this for a couple of years now, that we have a board policy that supports these children and their rights within the school district. The policy is not required. It is recommended by the State Department. We had our monitoring visit last year, which went very well. We got many kudos from the state, but this is one item that we had not been able to check off on our list, and we just think it's important so that, you know, we are publicly letting everyone know what the rights of these children are. And sometimes it's a little tricky, because even though we, our state law says that, for example, children need to come to school with their immunizations and we shouldn't admit them, we have to admit these children to school. And the part of what Peggy does and her program does is either help find the records or help them get their immunizations that they need. So there's some very particular things that are highlighted in this policy. This is the first reading, the draft, and I want to thank Mike Pavlakis for helping us with that. And so we're just open for questions right now on anything that's in there that you'd like us to clarify.
Questions from the board? Comments? Okay, Laurel?
Just a question, just to confirm the definition of what a student is transition. Is that the definition taken from the federal McKinney-Vento Homeless Act?
Yes.
Assistance Act?
Okay. Correct. Anything else?
Okay, before we, you know, vote on this, but let me ask you, you know,
it's discussion only tonight.
Yeah, or not, yeah. Just, what is the unaccompanied child? What is that category?
I'm going to let Peggy explain that, because she works with some of those students.
The unaccompanied child, usually in the middle and high school, only in the middle and high schools that I've come across in my 6 years of being here, they either run away from home or they're kicked out of home, but they're living somewhere under somebody else's roof, a friend or a relative. They don't have a guardian. They are considered an unaccompanied youth. We have 10 right now, 10 that were deemed unaccompanied since the beginning of this school year. They may end up going back home. They may remedy their situation, or they may become emancipated if they're of the age to have a job, and they remain on their own, which sometimes is the best thing, depending on the situation at home.
Okay, again, thank you both for the work that you do, and we'll look forward to you bringing back this policy for a vote. So.
And I did want to add that we are looking into right now funding that's available through the state for social workers in schools, and we'll be looking at that in the next couple of weeks. It's a short turnaround, and it speaks to a lot of the areas that Peggy's been talking about and the support that students need, not just our McKinney-Vento, but many students and families. So we're hoping to really be able to glean some of those dollars for the school district, and you'll be hearing more about that in probably another month or so as we go forward with that initiative.
Okay, thank you.
And may I add one more thing? I have dealt more with DCFS, Department of Child and Family Services, this year than I have in the past. But it's a good thing because we're connecting services. So where they were dealing with the family or the students solely without any support, we are now having that dialogue. So it's a huge breakthrough, and it's a good thing.
Okay. Thank you.
Again, thank you. Agenda item number 9. This is the presentation on the upcoming Science, Technology, Engineering, and Mathematics STEM Summit to be held at Carson High, the high school library, at 6 o'clock, Wednesday, December 9th, 2015. Alan and Amy.
Okay. Yeah. President Sforzik, members of the board, thank you. It's always a pleasure to come before you. That title sounded really long when you read it that way. I think that's why we say STEM. So we're... December 9th is actually slated as the second quarter community PLC. If you recall, I facilitate that and put those on. And we had originally slotted that to be a conversation around the work we're doing in family engagement. And there is work ongoing in family engagement, but we're going to move that report and that review to March because there's some more urgent work that came along. And that is an area of community partnership. So December 9th, which is, as you said, 6 o'clock at the Carson High School Library, is the second quarter PLC, and it's going to be dedicated to a curriculum review of the middle school work done in science and math, and also CTE and perhaps some art, depending on which teachers decide to come. And the reason that we've moved or changed that theme connects to the work that Mike Jackson is doing. His award is well-deserved, and I think it was two meetings ago that you got to hear Mike's presentation on the BEST program. Mike's had that vision for the BEST program for some time. It's been developing since last spring, and come April, we had sort of hit a wall. We weren't exactly sure how to take the next step for that to move forward, and as we got talking, we realized that we needed an opportunity to get people in the same room. And so Superintendent Stokes and Assistant Superintendent Kima invited Mike to speak to some elementary teachers that were meeting around science curriculum. And that happened, I believe it was May, that meeting took place, or early June. And so Mike gave his pitch, which was maybe 10 minutes, and then teachers were invited to sign up if they wanted more information. Our hope was that getting a motivated partner like Mike in the room with teachers would start to build relationships. Why do we want to start building relationships between teachers, classroom teachers, and partners? So for 2 years now, we've been working on a curriculum review through the Race to the Top grant, and grades 6 through 12 have been going through, breaking down the standards, and we've talked for 2 years about learning targets and collecting those targets then into units, and about after every 3 weeks assessing whether kids have mastered these targets. And we have that pretty well aligned, especially at the middle school and in the core at the high school. And so the focus for the last 2 years has been around content. So we're really good now at this point at what we want kids to learn, what order we think they should learn it, and how we're going to measure that. The next step is the context of learning. Because we can focus on content, and we can get kids to learn, and we can measure it, and they can master it in a unit, and we can move along through units to earn credits and earn enough credits to graduate. But it's really, graduation is not an endpoint, it's a starting point. And it's that context of learning that prepares them for what's next. So as educators, typically, we're very strong on the content. we're not as strong perhaps on how it connects to the real world. And it's that context that makes learning permanent, and it's that context of learning that motivates kids to learn. So that's what this summit is all about. We want the work that Mike Jackson is doing in fifth grade math to be duplicated. And we believe the way that we can do that is to get educators in the same room as community partners. So instead of having one Mike Jackson in a room with teachers, we're going to have as many Mike Jacksons as we can. So we're inviting people from business and industry locally to come and to hear not only Mike Jackson's presentation, but then Amy described it very aptly as a speed dating format. So we'll have a number of teachers there from science, math, and STEM, and perhaps art, as I said. Set up, it's almost like a science fair setup where they'll present the things that they're learning, the different units. And partners will have an opportunity to listen and hopefully make connections to what's being taught in the classroom and the work that they do in their businesses. And then there'll be some social time after. And our hope is that not only will partners connect to the content, but they'll connect to the people who teach that content. And then they will start to build those relationships like Mike Jackson has. And so in a nutshell, in the summary, we have an opportunity to hear firsthand from the teachers about the work they're doing. So celebrate the curriculum that's been developed. And then an opportunity for business and industry to connect to the work and also give us some insight into how it's applied here locally in business and industry. And then the third is to foster those relationships along with the best model.
Comments here? Oh, Joe?
How do folks in the community, business men and women, get in contact with you, and if they're interested in being a part of this?
Well, they can call the career office at Carson High School. But Mr. Stokes, we put together a list of invitees. In fact, there should be in your packet a schematic that shows the various business partners that we've already had contact with. And so we've sent a personal letter to many of the people that we work with already. I attend NNDA, and so I sent out a personal invitation to the members of the Workforce Development Committee in NNDA. I attended the GATE meeting and extended an invitation to the GATE parents. But they can also contact me, or they can contact Mr. Stokes if they're interested. And anybody that's watching, they're certainly invited to show up. Again, it's December 9th, 6 o'clock at Carson High School. It'll last 90 minutes. We'll start on time. We'll end on time. That's one of the commitments. But actually, I mean, it's very exciting. Again, that the idea that the context of learning is critical. Again, it's that motivating factor. It's what makes learning permanent. And these relationships might develop into a guest speaker program, a guest teaching program, similar to what Mike's doing. It might be what we call place-based. You'll hear this a lot. Place-based learning, where it's similar to a field trip, but it's got clear educational purposes tied to the content. It might be place-based learning for the teacher rather than the students. A term we use is an externship. So over the summer or over spring break, a teacher might go and spend some time at ClickBond, for example, making connections with the curriculum. One of the something that surprised me is when I would frequently get offers from partners to come into classrooms they wanted to come in, and when I would connect with teachers, teachers were sometimes resistant. And in talking with Amy recently, it's the pressure that teachers are under to teach the curriculum. They need to move through a certain pace to cover the content. And so every day, every hour is precious. And it is possible that a partner might come in and spend time making a presentation that doesn't necessarily forward the curriculum. So that's another goal of this December 9th meeting, and fostering these relationships in that when we have these extended experiences, we want to make sure that they are connected directly to what we deem important as education, and that is forwarding the curriculum.
Well, Ellen,
yes,
you know,
Mrs.
I think this whole thing is great. And Amy, you know, you...
She can give the most insight into the curriculum, and it's going to be middle school curriculum that we look at. So.
Okay, and what you just said, and then I'd like to hear from Amy. Yeah, what Mike did, and hopefully this is what happens, is no pressure on the teachers. When the teachers came to Mike, it was directly related to the curriculum. The teachers took the lead to say, could you do this, and let's develop it together. So Mike and the teacher worked together. So it was perfect. It was right on. And Amy, and I hope that's what where we're headed here. So, but Amy, go ahead. Let me hear from you, or let us hear from you.
Well, we're very excited about this opportunity. I know from the middle school science perspective, I support the middle school science teachers. One thing that they're interested in from community support is help in the engineering skills because they're confident in their science content, but how to transfer that to engineering is something that they would like some support in. So in the things I've heard from them is that could they be partnered with engineers who could help them look at the learning targets and make sense out of what does that look like in the classroom, how does that apply to college and career readiness, and that would help build their confidence and make sure that they're supporting their students in the best way possible. So that's something that I hadn't occurred to me. You know, you think of guest speakers or you think of field trips or open houses, but that idea of professional learning with the community was very exciting. And trying to think outside the box to how do we lower those classroom walls and make this community learning. And we're very excited about exploring that. And I've got some teacher leaders who are ready to step up and lead, and you'll meet them that night. And so we're very excited about it and this opportunity.
Well, Amy, we can, you know, take the time to thank you again for all the work that you've done in this, the Race to the Top and the Learning Guide. The whole thing that has been put together, you know, is unbelievable. And like you said, the next step is the context. And we go there and we've, well, it's unbelievable. But let me ask you this now. So your expectation is that there is some kind of a connection between a business partner and a teacher. Who's going to coordinate this? Is it then Alan at that night? Are people going to be signing up maybe or for more? And then secondly, this one night, but what's the follow-up? We want to keep it going. We don't want to just one an evening to say hello and we all feel good and leave. Do we have any follow-up or what's the follow-up going to be?
Alan and I were talking about that a little bit today, that we've got a nice schematic that he has created that kind of gives us a visual of the community, business and industry leaders who are interested in supporting and the different projects that are going on. And myself as the middle school science implementation specialist, and we've been working on community curriculum development, and Alan has been brought in on that to begin to coordinate so that the different players are not working parallel, but that everyone is informed and knows the different projects that are going on so that we can work together. So a step would be his coordination of that and his communication and understanding of that. And we thought at our event, again, going back to the speed dating analogy, is that the teachers would come, say, with their top five things they're looking for in a relationship, and the business and industry people would come with that as well. And when we meet, then we begin to communicate, well, here's what I was thinking I would like to offer, here's why I'm interested, or here's what would help me. And then we would take that information, again, Alan and I would compile that and synthesize it, and again, we could communicate that out, and then do the follow-up with ourselves as facilitators, with our department chairs, with our administrators, with the RTT director, just continue to come up with our next steps in that plan so that this moves forward and, like you said, isn't a one-night thing. Did that? Mm-hmm. Anything you want to add?
And now, you know, the announcement, I know Richard has sent out invitations. Will this be like in the Nevada appeal, Carson, now that, that you know, there's... Oh, we have... Okay, well, maybe it will be. No, I think it's important because this is something huge here. What you've been working on for the last 2 years, we're raising the bar. So this next step of bringing that community in full partnership in the context, actively connecting these kids to learning beyond the classroom is huge. And, you know, that's why I'm asking the questions, and I'll continue to ask the questions, not letting your work go unnoticed. You know, we want to, as a board, support all the work the teachers have done, and this is one step, and we just want to continue now in making this as positive experience that goes on for the next 100 years.
I think there's a lot to celebrate in that because the district has a clear vision and a clear plan in place. Like you said, the different pieces are coming together, and it's empowering us to be more efficacious. So by having that viable and transparent curriculum, by having clear learning targets, it's now easy for us to communicate with people outside the classroom, outside our school sites, with what our targets are, and for us all to begin to understand how we can support each other in reaching that and supporting our students. So it's very exciting.
Additional, Alan, you?
Yeah, well, I was just going to add to that. In the world of business, it's often phrased as, what's your ask? You know, you can be in a room and have a conversation, what is it you're after? Now that we have a clearly articulated curriculum, we have a clear ask. This is what we would like from you. Here's how you can support us. And I think Mike Jackson's work shows that when teachers have a clear ask, then that person can come in and meaningfully add to the classroom in a powerful way.
Great. Additional comments, questions? Well, thank you very both of you, and we'll see you December 9th, and right. We'll and beyond.
Yes, okay. And beyond.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay. Okay. Agenda item number 10: informational update of the most recent Smarter Balance Assessment Consortium. The SBAC for the 2014-15 school year. We have and Dr. Ricky Medina.
Susan Kima for the record, and Dr. Medina is on leave tonight. So I'm going to go through this slowly. Due to a test irregularity that occurred during the spring 2015 Smarter Balance test administration, the data that we have received will not provide an accurate reflection of student, school, or district performance. While this test irregularity is not unique to the Carson City School District, and this was a statewide issue that garnered national attention, we did have a better results of getting our students through the test, but the truth remained that only 30% of our state was able to finish that test. Therefore, we do not have accurate state results either. We put through the SBAC 3,462 students last spring. The test was covering English and math in grades 3-8. This assessment replaced an outdated test. It was much more complex. It was interactive. It required higher thinking skills and levels, and there were increased supports for students who were special needs or had language difficulties. It was expected we were prepping the board and our public for lower test scores due to a more complex test. And we were expected to use this data as a baseline to drive school improvement. This did not happen. While our students were exposed to the test And we believe that this type of test is more of going to be a true measure of students' academic performance. We did not receive accurate results. Since the irregularity, the vendor, Measure Progress, which is our former vendor, produced only some individual student reports for grades 3 through 8. We do not have performance results for all students. We do not have the customary district reports. We do not have the customary school reports that our administrators and that we use to inform you, the board, our public, and our parents, and the report information that our principals use to drive school improvement. Well, we know one test doesn't constitute learning. We know quality instruction does. We will continue to work on that until we can get to this year's assessment. Some of the students who did not get results is because during the test, graphics were too small to read, items not reading when they were supposed to. We had items that would not allow the selection of the correct answer. Initially, teachers and test coordinators were on the phone with Measured Progress trying to get the issue resolved. At some point, the direction from Measured Progress and the Nevada Department of Education changed to just have the students finish. This resulted in skipping questions. Because of the online adaptive nature of the test, the proctors were unable to determine that things were going wrong unless reported by the students. However, the students did not know what was supposed to work and what wasn't. For example, many of our students had the accommodation of text to reading, which did not work. However, they did not notice because they did not know it was supposed to be read to them. For the students who did get reports, we don't know that that is accurate information either. The normal process is that state provides districts with the data. We clean up the demographics. We make sure that our special needs students are accurately identified. We make sure that our students of two or more races are actually just that. We send that back to the state, and then they send us the final results. None of that occurred this year. We also know that some of those students who received data to the district were students that had technical difficulties but were able to finish the test. So they, too, have skipped answers but results. It's important to move forward. This test for 2015, NDE, the Nevada Department of Education, is not requiring us to use the data for the Nevada Educator Performance Framework. They're not requiring us to use the data for star ratings. Those have remained frozen from the year before. We have been in contact with our new vendor, DRC, which stands for Data Recognition Corporation. We've had our first monthly meeting with them, and things seem to be progressing in the direction we expect it to. There will be, in December or January, a statewide testing of the system where they want all students in Nevada to get on the system to see if it's going to work, and we'll continue to see progress made in getting ready for the spring testing. As a district focusing on learning, our middle schools are creating cross-curriculum activities between English and science and English and social studies to mirror real-world learning activities. Then as a result, the summative piece of that assessment looks like the SBAC. So as a district, we're gearing up. And as you learned in the last board report of the last agenda item that having a viable, rigorous curriculum that everybody knows what's expected, parents, teachers, and students alike, is a big deal. It is really what our taxpayers expect, but we have it here in this district. So as we send people to state testing meetings and learn about the cut scores, learn about what is expected on SBAC, we are adjusting our curriculum to make sure the rigor is at the expected level. At this point, I'd like to entertain any questions or comments.
Susan, I can understand the frustration with these systems. Given that, I'm curious, in the part where you've noted on assessments for 2016 that we're going to have access to new interim assessments and instructional tools, have we seen any of those yet? And why would we think that these would be any? I guess that's a question you can't answer. I mean, why would we assume that these would be any better than what we've already gotten?
So the state has now opened up a digital library for all districts to look at. They have just been requesting who are those people that are going to have access to the digital library first. I just sent that off last week. So I expect here probably before winter break that we'll be able to have access to looking at those supports for the schools.
You've talked about how we've not been able to judge the district or the schools or different things like this. How has the testing that isn't ready to go yet, has that hurt the student in any way?
It is one data point. When we are looking at placement for students in classes, making recommendations for honors, making recommendations for AP classes, making recommendations for certain levels within CTE, we use multiple data points. Now that we have curriculum and assessment developed in middle school through high school, and we're working on that for elementary, we can use other data points, the formative data points that teachers use every day. In some places, our measures for academic progress testing, our MAP testing. We can use end of unit assessments that the teachers created. We can use teacher recommendation for work ethic and attitude and those kinds of things that are also those intangibles that don't show up always on a test. We can use ACT scores. We can use high school proficiency scores. We can look at course history.
Right. So you're indicating that while important for comparisons on a planning level, this wasn't significantly important to measuring the progress of the student.
I would say yes. It's like when we go to a health checkup and we're looking at critical elements of our health, the SBAC is an academic checkup. It's important, but we don't practice taking our physical every day to improve our health. We change our behaviors. We look at nutrition. We look at exercise. And looking at student and academic gains, you need to look at that student and what happens with them every day, and that is quality instruction.
Fair answer. Thank you.
Questions, comments? No, I'd like to ask them, but it pains me just listening to you. You know, you can't feel all that comfortable. But I will ask just one question. If we want to go observe as this progresses, like you said, we've been in your report, we've been working on this now as a school district for 3 years on the SBACs. Is there a classroom, if I could pick a school, an elementary school, for example, and go and see how third and fifth graders, for example, are
Is that, I mean, are, is there a set time, or is it just incorporated within the course curriculum?
For all grades 3 through 8 for the SBAC, it's incorporated throughout the course curriculum. For the high school level, it's a same thing, incorporated throughout the course curriculum. Now, just give me a call and say, pick a school and what day you'd like to go, and then we set you up with seeing what a lesson looks like. At the middle school, at both Eagle Valley and Carson Middle School, that's where you'll see the English teachers and the science teachers talking about what does writing mean to science, what does writing mean to English, and how the vocabulary may be different, but the expectation as results are the same, and how they introduce one learning concept in one classroom and then do the lab in science and then together score a summative assessment. We can set that up.
Just one last question. Is Jace okay? I watching the football game with his, it looked like his arm was in a cast. Is he okay?
Yes, he's okay. Yes, it was in a cast. But it's okay. And he'll be ready for basketball.
Okay. Thank you. Agenda item number 11, discussion on newly proposed CCSD policy, first reading policy 260, the recess policy. Laurel, take it away.
Okay, thanks, Ron. This recess policy has been drafted. Just you guys are aware of the history. Apparently after No Child Left Behind legislation was enacted, several of the schools in our district that had three recesses minimized some recess in favor of more instructional time. This issue came to light this year because Fritch Elementary, which in years prior had three recesses, this year made the change to have two recesses. And several parents have come and expressed concern with it. So in looking into this, that's also something that Nevada doesn't have a policy on recess. They do have the wellness recommendation for 30 minutes of activity during the school day, but that doesn't apply to recesses per se. But there are lots of organizations out there on the internet that are urging states and local school boards to adopt policies. One of those is the American Academy of Pediatrics. And their information basically is what the policy is based upon. This policy statement was issued in 2003 from the American Academy of Pediatrics, entitled The Crucial Role of Recess in School. And they noted that recent surveys and studies have indicated a trend toward reducing recess to accommodate additional time for academic subjects, in addition to the withdrawal of recess for punitive or behavioral reasons. And then they've also noted that the time allotted to recess decreases as a child ages and is less abundant among children of lower socioeconomic status and in the urban setting. And they go through several studies. Their policy has 47 footnotes. And there are some of the research studies that they cite explain the optimal cognitive processing in a child necessitates a period of interruption after a period of concentrated instruction. The benefits of these interruptions are best served by unstructured breaks rather than by merely shifting from one cognitive task to another to diminish stresses and distractions that interfere with cognitive processing. And they point out that the studies indicate that the benefits of recess apply equally whether the recess is indoors or outdoors. And I know some elementary school teachers who would disagree for the indoor recess. When they've had too many days of indoor recesses, they will tell you the children need to be outside. But that when they have the opportunity for recess, they're more attentive and more productive in the classroom. They talk about the social and emotional benefits of recess, that children have the opportunity to develop their communication skills, negotiation, cooperation, sharing, problem solving, as long as coping skills, such as perseverance, self-control, and managing stress. These type of skills that they can develop will become lifelong skills. There's also the physical benefits of recess. The American Academy of Pediatrics recommends 60 minutes of moderate to vigorous physical activity each day. They maintain that recess can help a child to avoid the sedentariness and do that. They do not, however, they don't want recess to be a substitute for physical education, because physical education structure is focused more on structured involvement in teaching children an activity, making sure everyone is involved in it, whereas recess allows children freedom to choose. I liked the phrase that they use, that importantly, recess affords young children free activity for the sheer joy of it. If you've ever been on the playground when that bell lets loose, there's sheer joy out there. They note that recess should be safe and well supervised. Some of the concerns in some of the urban areas are that there's not a safe environment for children to safely recess, and they said that safety concerns alone should not be a reason to eliminate or diminish the recess. There's a whole section on structured recess, which has some benefits, but not as many. That could be sometimes the older kids, because then you run into the problem with structured adult-led activities where some children may not want to participate. The benefits of the unstructured recess are that the child has the opportunity to choose to socialize, to choose to be physical, and to be creative. And as far as the timing and duration of recess goes, across the United States, it varies. It's between 20 to 60 minutes is what they had found. They're looking to make a consensus for a number of minutes that should be regularly scheduled, but they don't have one at this time. They did cite that in Japan, primary school-age children have a 10 to 15-minute break every hour, and that this is thought to reflect that attention spans begin to wane after 40 to 50 minutes of intense instruction. But they do say to maximize cognitive benefits, recess should be scheduled at regular intervals, providing children sufficient time to regain their focus before instruction begins. And the last point that they make before they issue their recommendations is that, ironically, by minimizing or eliminating recess, it may be counterproductive to academic achievement, as a growing body of evidence suggests that recess promotes not only physical health and social development, but also cognitive performance. So their recommendations, they list six. Basically, those are what the policy that is presented includes. I minimized their recommendations in some cases for space and clarity. So that would be the only thing if the board, my thought was if there was more of the language, the six recommendations to include perhaps those recommendations. This draft was presented to the Wellness Committee, and it was endorsed by the Wellness Committee for approval to get the time started as a as something that this board values and recognizes is the importance of recess. As far as the actual minutes for recess, there's some discussion on that. I didn't put that in there because it seems that would fall more under a regulation than under a policy. So that's where that's at. If board members would request that we put something more in there, we can certainly consider that as well. So are there any questions?
Questions, comments from the board? Okay, in the third paragraph of the policy, mm-hmm. I mean, this is talking about the cognitive processing, academic performance depend on regular breaks. Okay, so that says, tells me how often. So I don't know if the Wellness Committee has gone to even discuss that yet. And then, and they should be sufficient, you know, time to allow. So how long those breaks should be. So if is the policy okay, and then the rest is got to be ironed out with a regulation as to the how long and how often?
Well, I think that would be if That's the minutes and the times right now. From what I've heard from parents, parents want a third recess. What administrators have relayed is that that takes away instructional time, and that they're concerned about if we added if they were required to have an additional 15-minute recess, that would be 15 minutes of instructional time that would be taken away, which seems to be the mindset on which this policy was issued by the American Academy of Pediatrics, because that's the mindset that they're finding has happened, and now they're saying, wait a minute, that's not working. I don't know if we want to put the minutes in here. Part of me wants to make sure that happens, and then part of me knows that then that will only be the minimum of recess that's given. And I don't know how that would apply if you have a minimum day, if we say, you know, you have three recesses, and then there's a minimum day, so maybe that falls better under the regulations, but that would be something we can consider. And also in that paragraph, I didn't know if we wanted to add the sentence that I left out from the recommendation under paragraph 2 on the American Academy of Pediatrics, that this applies equally to adolescents and to younger children. Because I think there's a notion that fourth and fifth graders sometimes don't need as much recess. You're still talking 10. You know, fifth graders are 10 and 11. And one of the teachers took me aside. I'm hearing more of it because I'm involved at Fritch and it's new at Fritch, and so I have parents that are talking to me, teachers that are talking to me. One of the teachers took me aside and said, if we don't have the recess, we still lose the instructional time because you have, quite literally, a stream of children going to the bathroom in the afternoon when they need to, and by the time everyone comes back from that, you can't say wait till recess or say it's we just came back from recess, you should have gone then and give me a ticket. They need to have them do it. So, you know, there's some statement that they still lose instructional time for that.
Okay, let's go back to the policy. Is it worded strong enough to say that there will be, via regulations, how often and how long these recesses will be?
It's not strong enough right now, I don't think.
Okay, well, would you suggest anything to make it stronger in the policy?
We could add a sentence in there that would include, you know, on regular school days that children should, you know, elementary school children should have a morning, lunch, and afternoon recess. You could put the minimum time of 10 or 15 minutes. I think the wellness policy says 10, you know, that breaks should be 10 minutes. Traditionally, it's 15 because it takes them a little bit to get out and play and get that.
Wait a minute. Dion?
So I know that we have, honestly, I'm a huge supporter of recess. And I'd probably, if I designed my own school, I'd probably have an hour of recess a day. But mm-hmm. I know we have certain requirements. I believe that I've heard, like, SFA, through our contract with them, we have to do 75 minutes a day. And, or I'm not sure if that's the number. Maybe it's 90. But there's an amount. I think there's a requirement now, a state requirement, to do something with science every day. I mean, I guess I'm just wondering, I would like to hear from maybe at your level or at the site level, you know, how are we going to work the timing in for all the things that we're, I guess, required to do with timing? And then if we're setting a policy for recess that has timing, do we want to set policies for other things that has that have timing on what sites are supposed to do? So I don't know how it all works together, and that's why I have a little bit of pause about putting timing in a regulation. I mean, I'm sorry, in a policy, because I don't know how all the pieces work together. And I think if we want to go down that road, it might be useful to have some type of presentation on that so that we all know what is required every day and the minutes that are required to be spent on different things, so that, you know, If we want to take that on, we should have a conversation, but it should be the complete conversation about that. So I don't know if you all have any initial thoughts on that.
For the guidance that I give the sites is that best practice for reading is 90 minutes a day. It doesn't matter what program you have. Reading is to be taught 90 minutes a day based on best practices. Math is 75 75 minutes. How they break that up, whether it's one chunk or throughout the day, that's up to them. And then the third point is with the science standards rolling out this year, there's expected to be an integrated block for science. Science standards incorporate the math and the reading standards, and teachers are new at planning for that. And those are the guidance requirements. Plus, we have requirements for lunch. We have requirements for time requirements for specialists in order, and also prep time.
Well, go ahead, Ryan.
I think we got here because we were talking about obviously the change in recesses at Fritch and I guess inconsistencies within the district with that. As I read this proposal, I don't know that it has to be minutes specifically, but if we're concerned with an afternoon recess, I think we have to address it. Otherwise, as this reads, nothing changes. I think this is the way it reads right now, it's really nothing. It's a synopsis of a paper. So I think we either have to lead or leave it where it's at.
Any other?
Would the question be that the time should be in the regulation as opposed to the policy, though? I mean, I don't disagree with you. I don't disagree that the discussion when we had it was, unless it's a requirement that we have recess, it's too easy to get caught up in the requirements and either recess is important or it isn't. But I guess what I'm asking is that if we were putting the time in, is it the policy or the regulation where we would do that? And maybe, Susan, that's something you would answer.
In general, as we are developing our policies for the district, the policy is more general. It's a philosophical statement, and then the regulation has specifics in it to be consistent.
Although I know this is going ahead, but I did note that the next policy we're looking at for emergencies does say fire drills once a month. So that some policies do have specifics in them. We don't have approval over, we don't vote to approve regulations. So if it's something that's important to the board, we could certainly add language to this policy that would minimize there should be a morning, a lunch, and an afternoon. And certainly you could do recesses as a reward. I know that Pinyon Hills Elementary has Friday frolics, where if all the students have completed their reading and their homework assignments, they have an additional extra recess in the afternoon. So that would be something that could be an incentive for students as well.
Okay, well, I'm only bringing this up because the way it is worded, in my opinion, you can see nobody is here.
Right.
So there is no sense of urgency at all.
It's the Tuesday before Thanksgiving, and school ended today.
But if something were in there that there will be scheduled recesses in the morning, at lunchtime, and in the afternoon, no times, but that's the policy of the school district, then the timing of that would come in the regulations, and I think we'd get just the words alone that there will be a recess in the morning at lunch and in the afternoon, probably people would show up because I think, Ruth Lee, and we want people because we need to know as a board, does it make sense or not make sense? And we need the administrators involved in the discussion. So I would just suggest that we put in the words that there will be a morning, lunch, and after no times, but at least we then have the people come to the table mm-hmm. and we can have the discussion.
And that could certainly be done. We can draft something. One of the considerations with whether or not it would make the school day longer, by and large, I've had parents tell me they're in favor of a third recess. Several of them had said, I would even let my children go longer during the day if they could have more recess. this. Some other parents are just as adamant that they do not want the school day extended. And there's the contract issue with our employees to consider for that time. I do know that our school day is longer. We start first bell at 8:25, ends at 3:15. Pinion Hills, as an example, because I know they were cited in the paper as having three recesses, they start at 8:50 and end at 3:10. So they have a shorter day and still fit that in. So that's just for comparison.
Okay. Well, then let's move it forward and put in some a policy that we will do this, but then how we do it, we need players at the table to discuss this.
Are there any other recommendations? Go ahead, Joe.
Well, I just had a question just on the committee that's discussing this. My concern's always with the teachers and how much we're putting on them. And now we're telling them, odds are we're telling them you're losing another 15 minutes out of your day, and we're not making the school day any longer, probably, because that's a bigger issue. How many teachers are on the committee, and are they elementary? And
the committee?
Eventually, before we vote on something, I would really like to get their input as to what are we doing to the classroom.
And that's, this is the thing that I don't, I think there's been some teachers who have attended, or there's been definitely administrators at the meeting who are also parents. I don't think we've had teachers. What I've found with teachers is they're hesitant to say something, particularly they talk to me, but then they tell me not to use their name because they have a new administrator or because they're at a different site with a different administrator, and they come and catch me in Target and tell me things. But I think there's a hesitancy on their part to jeopardize their position because they want to go along with it. Like I said, I did have the teacher who told me, we already lose the instructional time anyway because everyone needs to go to the bathroom. One of them said, without the morning recess, she doesn't have the opportunity to have a break and go to the bathroom because it's from 8:25 till 12:25 when they leave. So I think I've had several teachers stop me and say, now when are we getting our recess back? That's happening. We're looking into that and seeing. But I don't know that they will come out here and be public. I perhaps Mr. Wallace could ask the association for that.
Or he could represent
them. Yeah, and take a poll and represent for us.
With your permission, Mr. President, I know it's not public comment at this point on this issue. May I speak? Okay. Thank you. Brian Wallace, Holmes Bay County Education Association, the teachers union. The elephant in the room is the issue of teachers wanting to come forth and speak on this. Whether anyone here, I'm going to just say it point blank, the issue is test scores. You just heard about SBAC. And for the test scores on that aspect, knowing that's going to next year be our evaluation, and then any in-district assessments we create is also going to be part of our evaluation. What do you want us to do? They're very hesitant because there is an underlying competition in the district in comparison, especially at the elementary school level, that when one school is not rising up to maybe what another school is and certain things aren't taken into account, there is underlying pressure that's alluded to that we're not measuring up and don't speak up about these things. And, you know, we were just told at our principal's meeting, well, you know, you're not quite there like the other school is right now. Whether anyone wants to actually honestly come up and say it is up for the debate, but it's out there. And each of you as trustees, as you're stating, Trustee Crossman, have run into it. But they do not want to come forward because they are stuck. Instructional time is extremely important to us. I think we've made that very clear, not just as an association, but just as a profession within this town currently. But then you have items like this with the wellness component, and then you have parents. You want involved parents. Now you have involved parents, but maybe they're not involved where the district thinks they should be when it comes to a recess situation because we have test scores to worry about. And then back then the circle comes back to us as educators. It's part of our evaluations. And if we aren't measuring up in that, you unfortunately are going to most likely see some very valued educators in this district through K through 12 be rated minimally effective. And then the district's faced with a position within 2 years, depending upon those ratings, actually releasing them. So if you were a teacher, do you really want to wade into this at this point in time?
We've had teachers on that panel at the beginning, and most of them are the PE teachers. They're not usually the instructional classrooms, just for clarification. And right, yeah.
Sorry, Ron. No, see, and that's the challenge for me is you want to get an honest opinion from the teachers, in my opinion, and a lot of them are hesitant to come up and speak. And I don't know if it's I don't know what the best way to contact them is, if it's through like a lot of times when you go to these trainings, at the end there's an evaluation, rate the training, and sometimes I believe they're anonymous ratings. Other times they want you to put your name at the bottom. Can we get some kind of anonymous poll from the elementary school teachers? I don't know if that's a good idea or a bad idea, but I'd just be curious.
Well, I think we could all guess what the poll would be. Oh, yes, we would love to have an extra recess, but we need to do 90 minutes of reading and 75 minutes of math and whatever the time limit is for science, and we have specials, and we have, you know, speech, and we're evaluated on the growth of our students. So, I mean, it's not rock. Everybody wants extra resources. It's really the reality of, you know, if we, at some point, you know, we can say, you know, forget about the test and we don't care, but, you know, it's not really in our hands at this point because we haven't developed the training or the rating program, and we haven't really have a say in it. So at some point it will affect us. And so, I mean, that was really the point that I was trying to make when I made the original point, but of course Mr. Wallace is more eloquent than I am.
And in defense of the district, when it has come to surveys, because even with the board inquiring about the morales of staff in the survey and a little bit of pressure you put on the district on that, what I've learned in these, when even I've asked and said, hey, come to a board meeting, come speak up, come to do these things, that they need to hear from someone else besides this talking head, they don't. And so even with the association asking to come forward, they don't. And yet, when it's a survey, we have done everything we can as an association to ensure folks that there will not be retaliation, there will not be any kind of retribution, and that they are truly anonymous. But that is, unfortunately, one small component that still exists out there, a little bit of mistrust when it comes to surveys and what truly it means to be anonymous. And part of that, unfortunately, comes from being in a small, tight-knit district. There's only so many of us. And some of us write or speak in a certain style, especially write sometimes, that you can identify who we are. And that worries people sometimes still. So they have a tendency to still punch what they think people want to hear versus what they're actually feeling, regardless how much we can assure them. And the district has done that very well in assuring them it's anonymous. And if anything were to come of it, it would be dealt with accordingly.
Steve. Some of this seems a little confusing. And by that I mean, if we are to understand what we've read and what we've been given and for years and years, and we see it not just with kids but with adults, and it's that idea of interrupting yourself during the day to go do something physical helps you perform better with the rest of your time. I mean, we see plenty of people encouraged, employees of the state, we see encouraged to go walk for the 10 minutes of their afternoon break. And it's not because it gets in the way of performance, but it's the understanding from everything I've seen and read that it improves in performance. When I was involved in youth leadership, the understanding was, gosh, you got to stop every once in a while and let them go move their bodies around a little bit. Okay, so I guess my question is if this information is true, then why isn't aren't we looking at the fact that a recess would actually improve student performance rather than get in the way of it? But and that's what I'm not, I don't, you know, with the polls of how we feel about this or how the schedules run, either it's a benefit or it isn't.
I agree with Trustee Reynolds, and that's what I was saying. I mean, I would move to make...
We can't move. It's a discussion.
Well, I mean, I'm using a poor choice of words. I'm sorry. I would recommend that we add language that outlines maybe not necessarily minutes, but that our expectation is two recesses plus a lunch. And the basis for that, although I've heard the same fears from educators and administrators, but the reality is like what Ms. Reynolds was saying, like we probably just need to lead. The data's there, and that's what we were elected to do, was be leaders of the district. And, you know, I would sit on the side of two recesses plus a lunch. So just so you all know where I'm sitting at. And I think the data is pretty clear to support it. And chances are our kids will perform better with that extra time.
Well, who's preparing this policy? Is this...
Well, we just have a NASB training on this, and I know that they talked about it's not the board member's role to do that, but because I really just adopted the policy from the American Academy of Pediatrics policy statement, I was working on that, but I'd be happy to continue working on this with Mr. Stokes and Mr. Pavlakis to make that language. I think that's where I come down to is in my opinion, the policy statement from the American Academy of Pediatrics is very well vetted. It's good for the kids. You know, comments have been made that, you know, 30 minutes of focused instruction is better than 60 minutes of not as focused instruction. And if this gives the children the opportunity to relax, play, and focus, I think it would be good.
Okay,
for them.
Well, maybe you could work together, put it in, because I'd like to hear still from the teachers, from the principals. I want to. We I think need to hear from everybody involved in this. And Brian, you've been around long enough. There's no retaliation. We just need information to make a decision. And if nobody's going to come forward, then it's kind of like we work in a vacuum. We're not the educators. But we need to hear from the educators. So, and is that enough direction to do the
Would
to go
you like
forward?
This for the next board meeting?
Whatever makes sense.
Okay. I can get on it.
Mr. Stokes?
Thank you, Mr. President. If I might just add one thing for the trustees to consider or think about, and that would be the timing of when this would be implemented if it were to pass. And so just as an added maybe exercise as you're thinking about this topic, I know, for example, Fritch may be more attuned to having just gone to two recesses to where it might be easier for them in their scheduling of the day as opposed to someone or another school that may have had two recesses for the past 11 years. It might take a little more thinking and processing and consideration. And so I would just ask that as we take this next step, we also consider when implementation might be considered.
Another note is I don't see it directed at any specific grade levels or schools here too. I suspect it would not hold. Oh, elementary, okay, missed it.
just for drafting it, are there any thoughts on when it should be implemented while we're on it? Because we can't discuss it until next.
I think you say that in the regulations we can specify when, but I think Mr. Stokes makes a good point. We need to have that discussion. You know, it's just because just, you know, to have it make sense, we've got to have all the players involved. But if the policy goes through that they will, then there probably would be some kind of a sequence put in place.
And I don't want it to feel like we're circumventing the wellness committee either. So, you know, I don't want to feel like they're out of the loop, because the worst thing to do is to be on a committee and then feel like you're totally out of the loop, like they're doing whatever they want. Yeah. So just for reference.
Well, no, and take this back to the wellness committee. Yeah, take it back and say, in order to get the input that we need, the board, if we're going to make a decision, we need the input. And the wellness committee should be the first body.
The wellness committee is not meeting in December.
Mr. President, I was just going to add, as Trustee Crossman did, that the next scheduled meeting for the Wellness Council is the 14th of January.
Let's take it to the, change the wording, take it to the Wellness Committee, and then come right back here, and then at least we can keep this thing moving.
Agenda item number 12,
discussion of proposed changes to CCSD policy, first reading policy 805, emergency evacuation of schools. And Ryan Green, I hope you have as much fun as Laurel. So,
all right, well, how this started was really geared towards inclement weather. It was brought to my attention that some teachers and administrators that have been in the district for quite some time, even not even new ones, felt like there wasn't a known procedure or time that notifications would be given out if school was closed. It's my understanding we've never done a delayed start, but anyway, so that's where it started. I didn't think that was unreasonable as a parent, staff member, or a student to know that by X time I would know if school was going to be in or out or what the ongoings was. And so I went looking for the policy or at first I talked to Mr. Stokes about what it was anyway, and then I found deep in a policy called emergency evacuation of schools, there was a little snippet that said there would be a procedure. So what I did at first was I added into inclement weather, and with the help of Renee and Mr. Pavlakis, they took maybe my thoughts and then put them in a really nice way of writing it, better than I did. And so anyway, under inclement weather, it just outlined that the superintendent would come up with a procedure that will be written down and known for everybody within the district. I think it's totally reasonable, and for a few reasons. Number one, it's reasonable to know how to plan your day as a parent or a staff member. Number two, for succession planning, I think if the procedure is stuck in the superintendent's head, that doesn't help if for some reason he's gone or out or any number of things. And so to have a written known procedure, I think was totally reasonable. And then so once I got to reading the emergency evacuation policy 805, there were many other things housed within that. It obviously was created after NRS, as Laurel brought up. NRS dictates that schools monthly will do either a fire drill, a shelter in place drill, or lockdown. And so that's where that came from. But also, after talking to Ms. Wiswell, she's reworking on our emergency plan. And the policy, I felt vaguely addressed that. So I wanted to really shore up that addressing. And after speaking with her and hearing what the work that she's doing, I would feel comfortable reporting to you all that the district is doing a good job in updating that policy. And I think we'll be hearing from them shortly for our annual review of it. Anyway, so long and short of it, I tried to, and this was probably Ms. Cortez or Mr. Pavlakis more than me, this got sectioned out into where, so first of all, it wouldn't be the emergency evacuation of schools anymore because it's that policy name didn't do enough to say what was in it. So it's just an emergency preparedness policy or fire drills, inclement weather, dictates the three sections. And then, I mean, each section, as you read them, speaks for itself, really. The first two, fire drills and crisis and emergency, are pretty much straight out NRS. There isn't, it's a lot like the McKinney-Vento or any of these other policies where we just sort of take that language and have our policy with it. That's my presentation.
Let me ask a question. You're talking with our risk manager, and when she was here, one of her first priorities was on some kind of a emergency preparedness. Are we duplicating, or what are we doing?
No, she was speaking of this. This is what she was saying, her first priority to work on. When we had lost our last risk manager, you're supposed to review this annually, and it's been about a year and a half, as I understand. So that's why it was really high on her priorities. And so
it wasn't the policy, it's the plan.
It's
the plan.
That's the difference. Okay. She was talking about the plan that we have to have. This is the policy. Okay. And she hadn't I don't think she was thinking policy at the time, to be honest. Yet.
Where is our risk manager? If this is a policy under her purview,
right?
Shouldn't we have her here?
I was just speaking with her today, Ms. Wiswell, and you're right, Mrs. Wilkie. Her first priority was to get the plan updated and together so that we're all on the same hymnal with regard to emergency procedures. She was curious, actually, to know what would develop after tonight with regard to suggestions you have about the policy, because it would obviously dovetail with her work irregardless. So
hopefully that helps. And that's kind of my thing. How did it come about that the inclement weather went with these two? Because when we go look, I think one of the problems I have with our stuff is when I go to the website, when I get asked what our policy is, and I can't find the policy because it's written under some other heading. So I'm afraid if the reason we did this was inclement weather, couldn't we just have a policy on inclement weather and leave the safety one to do something else, because we have SB 205 too that had to be update our policies? Or is this the update of our policy through SB 205? I mean, it just seems like we're trying to cram a lot into one thing.
Okay. So after I talked to Wiswell, we were going to break them out into two. But in the meantime, the rewrite had happened with the three headings. And so when I read it, I thought, all right, I could care less if it's in two or one. I think the most important part is a proper heading so that it could be found. Because
exactly.
I just happened to check in emergency evacuation of schools and found that there was a small portion of that that did address inclement weather, which
would be a perfect reason.
Yeah.
Inclement weather may be a reason for evacuating a school, perhaps.
Correct, but not for delaying start or closing prior to start of school. And so I agree, and that was what Ms. Wiswell wanted, was to actually break that out into its own. I'm indifferent either way. I don't mind it like this, as long as it clearly states in the title the intent of all the parts of the policy.
Michael?
I, too, spoke with Ann, and she was unable to make it tonight. The policy is not inconsistent or is consistent with SB 205. In fact, they do go hand in hand. She is working on the development of a plan as opposed to a policy. And if you would like to have this broken out into two or even three separate policies, we can do that.
So the development committees and the school committees, is that part of the state requirement?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay, that's what I thought I heard. So, okay, that's required.
So on that, so our it says developmental committee. So that's actually our emergency operating plan committee. But we don't have to put that in there. It just can be a developmental committee like the NRS has. Okay.
I have one other question. I'm confused by the sentence, the plan and deviations are confidential and must not be disclosed to any person or governmental agency or political subdivision. That seems contradictory to the idea of having a plan that can be communicated. Is that what the state, is that what, okay.
I'm probably going to summarize Mr. Stokes here in our conversation, but so for that, this crisis and emergency plan, think of active shooter, terrorist incident. So it's not putting it out to the public what our internal procedure is. However, plans that deal with like the shelter in place and then reunification and stuff, those plans are a little bit different than the crisis or emergency management plan. And that's why it's not shared.
Would we then review that and adopt it in a closed meeting? No?
Typically, you've received a report from the committee that the plan has been adopted.
Okay. Oh, okay. Because the second paragraph on the bottom of the first page, the plan developed by the development committee shall be presented to this board for adoption. And once adopted, the plan shall be reviewed annually. So do we adopt the plan? We don't look at it. We can't meet unless we're open meeting. So if it's not to be shared with the public, how do we adopt it and present it to us?
And Trustee Crossman, that could be done in a variety of ways. For example, if you see the plan, it has in bold red letters right on the front, not for public distribution for the reasons that Trustee Green mentioned. I remember when the first document was actually done, I think it was the first year I came, and at that time it was considered good form to mail those emergency plans home to all of the families, and they were created for that purpose. And then as other events happened in the country, that thinking changed now to this condition to where we're a lot more careful. But we could have those available at the district office for trustees to come and look at. We could give you copies for you to consider and read without them, you know, and then just have you give them back to us so that we could collect them so that they're not just out for the public. But there's a variety of ways we could make that information known to the trustees.
Okay, what I would suggest, you know, Ann is not here, but what I think we should do, I think we're talking about all this confidentiality. For inclement weather, we're not talking about confidentiality. We're talking about should we be here or not be here. Why don't we separate that into a separate policy? And I think there's a lot of questions that need to be addressed by our risk manager going forward on the other parts of the policy. Okay, can we just...
I think that sounds good. I just had a couple other comments before we move on. Okay. The members of the development committee, is that required by the state? Okay, because I was going to say, shouldn't our risk manager be a member of that committee? Maybe we could have an additional parent. I don't know if we keep it to the minimum in case they don't want to volunteer. And then my other question is... with what the plan should include, it doesn't list a procedure for reunification, which is sometimes the most difficult thing is to reunite the kids with their parents. And I don't know if it's required by state law, but maybe that would be something to include in there.
It's in the plan.
Yeah, it's in the plan. maybe we should have it there. And then fire drills, is it once a month that they do fire drills?
Yes.
Or is it fire drill, earthquake, or lockdown?
It's one or the other.
One or the other. Could we call it something like emergency drills because it doesn't just cover fire drills?
That's NRS.
Oh, NRS says it needs to be called a fire drill
section. Well, then
section.
Say that's just how NRS refers to
it. Oh, okay. I don't know. I just thought it was broader.
I know there was a push with the legislation when Benitez Thompson was working on it in the assembly to get so that it was a lockout shootout because that's been more appropriate than the fire drills. And somewhere between there and SB 205, it got dropped.
Steve.
I'm curious. There's two paragraphs in the old policy that when you have emergencies, I guess it strikes me as being important. And there, the third from the last and the last one, the third from the last says the superintendent may close the schools, delay the opening, et cetera. And the last one, of course, in the instance of early closing of the schools, the superintendent shall notify the board. Are we being contradictory to the statute if those paragraphs might still be included in a new policy? Okay, because I think that there needs to be, I think we need to have a policy where we say if something happens, somebody needs to do something. And that's how I read those.
I just, from my own understanding, Ryan, I like the idea of this. I think we need some clarification. It's hard for me to really digest it, though, until I see the plan, or plans, if you will. But I have no problem with this, you know, basically as it is. But I would be interested to, you know, to see how these plans develop and what they say. That's the meat of the whole thing.
I think Mr. Silks can probably speak to this better, but we actually already have an emergency plan. And he has a procedure he's been using for inclement weather. My understanding of the inclement weather one, there wasn't, although they had their own thresholds they were using, I don't think it was well enough put out to the staff. And so I think he could probably produce both of those for you pretty darn fast.
Okay, for purposes of this, though, why don't we just separate them? And let's get the inclement weather policy.
Do you want your fire drills also separated out?
I think that should be a risk manager. And all of them should be under the purview of the risk manager. But the inclement weather is one that is by itself. And I think we should just address that, and then whatever has been done in the past, bring that up. And then if, you know, but there will be a policy for inclement weather, period.
Okay.
And then we can discuss it and get that out of the way. And the other one, Ann's got to be here, our risk manager, to ask some specific questions. Just on the policy. I know the plan is something else, but the policy, we want to hear from her.
And just, I would agree with Steve that we should still include language in the emergency plan that the superintendent can have a procedure for closing, delaying, or dismissing schools. I'm just thinking back what happened in Douglas County a month ago when they had a credible threat. They were looking for someone. That should be an opportunity that, or, you know, yeah, they can do that.
They can bring both of them back at the same time, and we can go through them and move those forward.
Okay, any additional comments on this? If not, we're going on to agenda item number 13, discussion and possible action on the superintendent's evaluation for the 2015 calendar year for possible action.
Hey, can we take five?
We'll take five. Okay. We're in recess for 5 minutes.
This is a random.
reconvene, and we're on agenda item number 13. I'll state it for the record again. Discussion of possible action on superintendent's evaluation for the 2015 calendar year. This is for possible action. Okay, all of us have the evaluation form. Each one of the sections, for example, leadership and district culture, policy and governance, those are standalone sections, each given a total point evaluation of 4. What will happen is, you know, I will ask for each of the board's evaluation on each of the sections. Renee is going to record the numbers, and at the end, then we'll do the total score and come up with the evaluation as to whether Mr. Stokes is superior, very satisfactory, or need to improve. All of us received the superintendent's goals, and before we make final determination, we'll open it up for questions, if any have questions or comments regarding his goals, and then we'll ask Mr. Stokes we'll ask if there's any questions he has of this evaluation or anything he would like to add. If there are no questions from the board, we'll begin the process with the annual evaluation matrix. And Renee, are you ready? Okay. And I'll just start, and we'll start with Steve at the end and work our way this way, the leadership and district culture.
I think this is an area that's a high point of our district, and I would select the superior rating.
Dion?
I would agree.
Okay. Stacey?
I went with very satisfactory.
Okay.
I did very satisfactory as well. I gave it 3 there. Reading through the bullets, I think we do most of those better than satisfactory. The only things that, like the one bullet about the continuous improvement process, I don't know that we have that, but I've never heard of it, so that gave me a little question. The reason that I didn't give it a superior score, though, is I think if we had a real culture of learning and a reputation for academic performance, we would have families and employees beating down our doors to come here, and we don't have that yet. Although I think we are building something special here, I don't think it's out. And so that kept me from going further with that.
Laurel?
I went ahead and did superior. I think we're a pretty well-known secret.
Well-known secret.
You know,
okay, so yours was superior.
Okay.
Joe?
I had very satisfactory. I think we're doing some great things. I think Superintendent Stokes is doing some great things. I think always pushing on that student achievement number is kind of where I'm, you know, the jury's still out on some of this stuff. And so I thought there was just a little bit of room for growth there. But all in all, I think very satisfactory was fair for me.
My rating is superior in this area.
Policy and governance slash employer superintendent relations. And this time we'll start with Dion.
I think superior on this one.
Stacy?
Very satisfactory.
Ryan?
I gave it satisfactory, and I'm going to go bullet by bullet because I just think it's appropriate if I'm going to give feedback also. I think the first one, I think he does a good job of working with us as a board. He's always available for sure. There were a couple of things to note this year, though. I thought the high school physical should have been handled better. I'd already spoken with him earlier in the year about our procedures for that, and then we still only gave out a notification a half day before those came through. I think the demographic questions before the test could have been handled better, or the opt-in and opt-out procedures. I think it could be a better advocate for family privacy. I did think two of the bullets needed improvement. I think establishes procedures for successful superintendent board interpersonal and working relationships. I'm not aware of any established procedures. So I said needs improvement because we didn't go through any. And then takes active responsibility for executing district policies. Just in the first three policies, and I asked about these when I very first got on the board, policy 020 says we need to review every policy every 4 years. That's not being done. Policy 030 says there should be the evaluation instrument for the superintendent should be given to him at least 6 months preceding the evaluation. That didn't occur. The orientation, policy 040, orientation for new school board members should be provided with. There's a whole list of materials within there that we're all supposed to be provided with. Most importantly, probably the superintendent contract. Now I could ask for it, I guess, but it's supposed to be provided. Maybe we would have seen the automatic renewal had we had that. So I think that area definitely could use some improvement. I think he's superior at understanding and interpreting the laws and the rules. And I think he does a very good job of appointing the appropriate people in the right places to write grants and be stewards of programs. I think he also uses the legal in a superior fashion to avoid liabilities. So overall, I give a satisfactory, like it meets expectations, but I don't see any reason to go higher.
Laurel?
Oh. Can I ask a question? So on the one of those things you said there was the opt-out on the physical. So I know there was public comment on that, but was that actually looked into? I mean, did you get a... Okay, so that was the actual case that happened, that it was only the day before, or...?
It's fine.
Because I know sometimes, you know, we get those reminder messages, either through email or phone call, the robocalls, but a lot of times those come after a sheet has been sent home or some other process. So I just wanted to make sure that that was actually reviewed and looked into, and not just that there was a public comment that that happened. And
Laurel?
I did superior on this. I appreciate the weekly updates, the availability to the board at all times for keeping that. As far as working with the policies, we've been working with them. So,
Joe?
Excuse me. I gave superior here as well. I think there's always a little bit of room for improvement. I think my interactions with the superintendent and how I've seen him conduct himself with staff and his open door policy and whatnot, I'm pretty happy with it.
And I also gave him a superior. Steve?
I have it. It's very satisfactory.
Okay, on to community relations and communications. And we'll start this time with Stacy.
Well, this is one I still think we're just trying and trying, but we're just not getting there. And I don't know why, but it just seems like we're having trouble with the two-way communications between the public and the board and staff. So this is still the one that I think we need to keep honing in on. And so I gave satisfactory.
Ryan?
When I, the way I broke out and scored these, I actually ended up with an average of 1.8. But I'm going to put satisfactory as my total, because I have the ability to round my score however I do it. However, I think as far as needs improvement, I think lead staff and the effective two-way communication with students and community, I think like Ms. Wilkie was referring to, we had the, I watched last year's review, and this was brought up as a point from last year. And we're still bringing it up. So, I think the needs improvement as far as the two-way communication is really important. We had the cheerleading drama where the parents felt compelled to come to a board meeting one by one. The recess and wellness policies, I point to those as the implementation of the wellness policies. It sounded like it was a little inconsistent between sites. Some of this I take some ownership being new on the board. I wasn't paying attention, but I think when we did that wellness policy in the summer, the early parts of the summer, I think that was probably poor timing on our part for just like we're talking about with the recess policy. If we want people to interact, I think that would be a spot where Mr. Stokes could have been a better steward for that. And then also, I think Mr. Brown took a lot of the brunt of a lot of this stuff when I know at least I mentioned in our meetings when we were passing it that we should have taken the brunt of it, or district admin. I don't think it's fair that we ask our staff to take that, the brunt of policies that we put forward. I do think that I give a very satisfactory for effective communication skills. I think Mr. Stokes is a really good communicator. He promotes involvement with stakeholders, satisfactory. And then the bullet that establishes effective community school relations, I think we have a lot of programs that are in their infancy, and I have a feeling by next year all this is going to move up. But I think at the moment it's satisfactory because we don't know if it's effective yet, but it's moving forward. The only other area that I thought needs improvement within that category was the understands and uses media opportunities to shape and form opinions and relations. And the reason I put needs improvement was last year, even in the superintendent eval meeting last year, it was mentioned that, or Kat was hired. That was the presentation. And now we have the glossy pamphlet. But other than that, sitting in front of us now, and the principal's writing some articles in the paper, I couldn't think of anything or point to anything to where we've been utilizing it a lot. So I'd put needs improvement there. But overall, I'll just give it a satisfactory for the.
Laurel?
I have very satisfactory here. I think that there is a lot of effort with the community PLCs and involving the community members. I think the best program that is coming forward, those type of things can involve businesses, school businesses, and community. The only reason I didn't do Superior is because there's still that communication that, and we, you know, it's hard to communicate sometimes with people who aren't answering. But and perhaps we could branch out. You know, well, sometimes parents, you know, get overloaded and don't want to do it. And but perhaps we could branch out more with some of the social media to have a site for updates to tell the good that's happening in our school district, because there is a lot of good. I think for the most part we do broadcast that quite a bit, but I know there's a Twitter account now, thanks to Natalie Wood. So yeah, I talked to her.
Okay, Joe.
I did very satisfactory. I think Mr. Stokes does all in all a great job communicating. I think the breakdown we have, and I'm not sure exactly where it is, but when I hear certain parents come to the podium and talk about, you know, getting last-minute notices about things, that I think we can certainly improve there. And so for that reason, I thought there was a little room to grow.
And I have very satisfactory. I think we've come a long ways. Is there a ways to go? Always in communication, there's a ways to go. Okay, Steve?
I have very satisfactory. And in looking at much of this, I guess there's not a lot of media of opportunities, but I know in the last year there were substantial articles in the Nevada Appeal that were written by Nevada Appeal reporters. Really, as I was watching the media, the newspaper and the others, it almost seems like excessive coverage of the school district. I mean, we've not only come a long ways, but we've got well over the average when it comes to that. One of the things that I've also enjoyed about watching how Mr. Stokes conducts himself in the district as opposed to other districts that I've watched is it seems like the teachers and the students and what's going on in the schools tends to get the attention, as opposed to seeing maybe what I see at a bigger districts where it's always the district office this or the superintendent that. And what I've appreciated about his leadership is it is one that's done from behind the scenes more than in front of it. So anyway, that's just my opinion.
Dion?
I have satisfactory for this one. And really what my comments on this go back to what a comment that Ryan made on the first one, I think, which is that we have so many, I mean, we're a race to the top school. We have so many things that we're doing here. It's an exciting place and it's an exciting time, but we don't have the people, you know, rushing to come here. And so part of how I feel is that's kind of a lack of message. And I'm not saying that we're not doing, we're not having articles or we're not communicating, but just kind of bringing that all together and really, you know, selling what we're doing here and promoting it in a way that kind of builds this excitement. And I think we're doing it in some, you know, like in our pockets, like with our community PLCs, but just kind of that overall vision of what that looks like and how we bring it together and really present it in that way. And I understand that, you know, Mr. Stokes isn't a PR person, and having those types of programs and stuff costs money, but, you know, really like kind of giving some more thought and a little bit how we do that. In terms of the communication with us and the communication with the schools, I mean, I know that the cheerleader stuff was brought to us, but I think Mr. Stokes was trying to work with a very contentious group of people battling back and forth, and I think he was open and willing to do that. So I think that's good. And then my final comment is just, you know, again, on the communication with families and parents, is that you know, how we use our resources. Like, we have our one-to-one devices, and I know not everybody's plugged in, but just really encouraging sites and teachers to utilize those communication tools, whether it be through Edmodo or however more we can use those resources to make sure that parents kind of know what's going on. And I know we're going to do Mastery Connect in a few months, and, you know, but just promoting those tools and promoting them inside the campuses so that teachers feel comfortable using them and have the resources and are supported in using them as communication tools, because I think that's really a way that we can reach out a little bit more that we're not doing necessarily as much of right now.
Mr. Sorzik, if I could just add to the body of knowledge, in speaking with the high school regarding the cheerleader episode here in Carson City, it's not isolated. In fact, the first 7 real cases of bullying in the state are cheerleaders across the state. I just want you guys to know that they're out there, and it's not just Carson City, it's statewide. 7 cases right now.
Okay, starting with organizational management, we're going on to page 2. And Ryan, we'll start with you.
For overall score, I said satisfactory. I think you definitely superior in gathering and analyzing data. I think AJ's hire is a real testament to that. I think that Mr. Stokes makes most of his decisions are calculated and thoughtful, and I think largely data-driven. I gave satisfactory for the long-range plans. The only bullets in that category I think needed improvement, but I'm already seeing improvement, is the good thing. The facilities management plan, you know, starting back last spring when we were doing the budget stuff, but then now we're developing that. We have that committee now. And then also the procedures for dealing with emergencies, which we just talked about. And the reason that I was on the fence with that is, like, Trustee Crossman last year in the evaluation brought up our reunification during lockdown procedures, and we're still sort of talking about some stuff now, although in a little bit different light, but it tells me, you know, and even in just what I was dealing with policy 805 over the last few weeks, we have not hammered that down. So hopefully we're doing that, and I think Ms. Wiswell is definitely a step in the right direction. I think Sheriff Furlong with the police officers grant or school resource officer, whatever we're calling them, I think that's a fantastic step in the right direction too. So I have it all just satisfactory right now, and I hope next year we're going to be really excited about it.
Laurel?
I have this as superior. I think the long-range plans, there's a plan for maintaining the technology. Master Planning Committee is meeting again. And I would just say on the cheerleading incident as well, this is one of the first times with the new bullying regulations and reporting, and so our administrators were learning how to do that as well. And that could have caused some issues with the parents as they went through all the steps that are new to parents as well. So,
Joe?
I had very satisfactory. I think, again, Mr. Stokes, you know, I'm impressed with how he does most of this stuff. I think the third bullet, develops and monitors successful facility management plan. Sorry, throat's breaking down on me here. Maintenance and replacement programs. It's more of a sign of the times than anything, but maintenance and replacement programs, you know, we're struggling sometimes in those areas. And then in terms of the student bullying, when we reference the cheerleaders, thanks. You know, that whole issue to me was kind of a breakdown at the school site level, but being in charge of the overall district, you know, just it's another area for improvement. How can we address these things? But all in all, I think he's doing a great job there, and I gave very satisfactory.
And I give him superior. I just, you know, look around, and I think what Richard is doing is addressing just a lot of things organizationally, and in any school district, there is going to be fluid things going on. But does he avoid them? No. Does he try to take steps? And he does take steps to make them better. So that's why I give him a superior.
Well, and, you know, with just the organization dealing with emergencies, how well the flood at the Early Childhood Center was handled and all of those students were relocated to another site within a week. That's a lot of good stuff.
Steve?
I have a superior for this, and a lot of it's, I think we've had a fairly successful facility management plan. I think we've done a great job with planning for community financial support. Our technology is well ahead of most districts. I mean, I think compared to most districts that our organizational management has defined is well above board.
I have very satisfactory.
Stacy.
Very satisfactory.
Okay, educational program, curriculum planning development. And we'll start with Laura.
I have very satisfactory on this.
Joe?
I had superior. I think, you know, as I'm learning about being on the board for 3 years, this whole curriculum, it's a challenge. And the first bullet almost makes me laugh, stays up to date in curriculum, because I can't figure out what that means. And I think you're doing a heck of a job. Every time we sit here and people come in, six people are for something we do and six people are against it. And if we were to change it, we'd have a different six people for and against it. So anyway, superior.
And superior for me. I think he's done a remarkable job in this area.
I have superior. Yeah. I think this is something we're very good in.
I have very satisfactory, and just a couple of comments on this that you know, I know it talks about data and it talks about looking at data as you know, as a decision point. And I've said this before, and I would like us to kind of start having these conversations, or at least to start thinking about, you know, how we move away from this single point at the end of this, the end of the year, and kind of using our data points along the way. And I know Mrs. Kima talked about, we have a lot of data points that we look at, and we do, but we do look at that one data point as kind of feeling like the most important and the most pressure filled. And so just kind of along those lines of looking and broadening that as to, you know, not relying so much on that to the extent that we can.
Stacy.
Superior.
I gave superior. I think we need to stay the course. I think we have a well laid out plan, and I think you're doing a very good job. And I'd say keep implementing and staying fresh and lead in this area, because I think that's what we're doing.
Okay, moving on to instructional leadership, professional and leadership development. And Joe, we'll start with you.
I had very satisfactory. Again, I think Mr. Stokes does a really good job here. My only, where I struggled between superior and very satisfactory was when we're talking about training to support student outcomes. You know, I've kind of advocated for finding a way to keep teachers in the class a little bit more. And I know we have to pull them out to train them and all that. And I hear sometimes from teachers that some of the trainings they're attending aren't necessarily as grade appropriate as maybe they would like them to be. And I just think that's an area we can maybe, hate to say improve on, but strive to find a better way to, I don't think we'll ever completely get there, but try to make sure that we're as grade appropriate as we can be. But very good, very satisfactory.
Okay. I gave him a superior.
I have superior, and I think the whole basis for what we're doing with Race to the Top is on the fact that we're not only ahead in the state, but we're setting some standards that maybe are going to be followed with on the national level. I mean, this is, again, this is one of those areas I think we're very, very good in.
I have very satisfactory.
Stacy.
Very satisfactory.
Ryan.
I gave very satisfactory. I think, at least for me, even to tread into the superior realm of this is almost arrogant. I think we should always maintain room to improve. Especially in this portion, because that's how you fall off the top once you think you're at the top.
Laurel?
I have very satisfactory.
Okay, we're moving on to human resources management, staff, and personnel relations. And I've got a superior rating.
Steve? I've got a superior rating.
Superior.
Very satisfactory.
I gave satisfactory. I think he meets standards in this category.
I'm between superior and very satisfactory. I'm looking at it going, okay, where would I put this? I'm going to go with superior because I've got 3 out of 5 with superior and the other 2 very satisfactory.
Okay, Joe?
I had superior here.
Values and ethics leadership. Steve?
I have superior here.
Me too.
Me 3.
I gave satisfactory.
Superior.
I gave superior. I really appreciate Richard's, the way he conducts himself in our conversations and the way I see him handle himself in the public. I am pretty impressed with the way he handles himself.
I would agree, superior. Okay, financial management and business matters. And we'll start with Steve. Dion.
I have superior for this one as well. I think, you know, in these last 3 categories, I think Mr. Stokes is a good steward of the public money and, you know, he works hard to make the most of the funds that we have available. So I think he does a good job here.
Superior.
I gave very satisfactory. I think you're doing a good job.
Superior.
And Joe?
Yeah, I agree with Dion. I gave superior. I think he's a very good steward of the public's money.
Superior, and then Steve.
Superior.
Okay.
Superior.
Okay, report on Empower Carson City 2017, and we'll start with Stacy this time.
Very satisfactory.
I gave it satisfactory, and for a few reasons. Number one, this question with the bullets is, I mean, it's really a yes or no question. It's to rate, it's ridiculous, but I almost gave it a needs improvement, and the reason is last year's eval Mr. Reynolds brought up, because Mr. Swerzik and I think Mr. Cassiopo had brought up that they wanted more bullets. There were specific things that they wanted in this category that were not included this year. He's in charge of everything. As you read the contract and everything else, plus I think us going back and forth about how we evaluate our own personal evaluations is not the right place to do this. Anyway, so I gave satisfactory. I think you're implementing the the plan well.
I've got superior, and I'd specifically the one-to-one mobile that is grades 3 through 12. The student-based health clinic, when Empower Carson City was first developed in 2012, those were kind of pie-in-the-sky ideals. And we're not even, we're just getting to 2016 and we've already got those. So I put superior.
Joe? I put superior. I appreciate what Ryan said as far as this category itself, but I don't, for me, it's not a reflection on Mr. Stokes. It's just we might want to in the future build on that, but for the purpose of Mr. Stokes, I appreciate the reports he does, and on the times I've spoken to him, I've gotten the questions answered I've needed.
Yeah, and I would, because of the way that this is worded, report on Empower Carson City 2017, I mark it superior. I'm is superior. And Ryan, in answer to your questions, last year I brought up, yeah, there was more, and it had to do with community in full partnership and objective 1.1. But in Rich's report, he addressed it, and we've been working. We were going to work together through the year, and we have. And things have happened as far as Mike Jackson's and the best through the foundation. We've got another one, Southwest Gas, which is coming forward, lending some additional information on how we could have both in-class and extended programs. And I think Richard has done just what he said he was going to do. And so I've rated him superior. And maybe for the next year, we can maybe change this on the wording. Maybe it's more than a report. It's more of a set of recommendations, especially with the strategies. What are we doing? What is the next step? What is the follow-up? So, anyway. Steve?
I have it as superior, and I also recognize that not only has there been reports to us, but it also reports to the Board of Supervisors and to other entities in the community regarding how the district's doing on Empower Carson City. So.
Yes.
Superior.
Oh, I thought I started this.
Oh, did you start it?
I think so.
What's what you said?
Would you like your vote to count twice?
Sure. It is getting close to 10, so.
Okay. All right. Is there, okay. Now on the, what Richard has provided with the superintendent's goals, are there any questions, comments, on what he's provided us. Now, and I'll say this, you know, we go to the NASB conferences, and you see other school districts and board. I had the occasion to talk to, well, I won't mention who, but what Richard has done here is a little bit more than most do in this regard. And I think we're really fortunate to
to have him as a superintendent leading leading our educational endeavors. So, but anyone have any? Joe, go ahead.
I'd just like to say to Mr. Stokes, I appreciate you taking the time to do the goals. They're helpful for me. They help reinstate a lot of what we're trying to do here. And I think they're needed. I think, for me, the end result is always, how are we doing? Where is our student achievement? And it's a tough nut to crack, if you will. But I think by having a detailed set of goals like this, it allows me to kind of, help stay on, kind of track these things. And so anyway, I appreciate it.
Okay. Ryan?
I really appreciate the goals. I appreciate it in that I'm a goal-driven person. I feel comfortable saying you are too. It keeps you on track, and I think the really exciting part about this is you basically met every goal or superseded it. And I think for the overall evaluation, I just want to say I think you're doing a good job. I think I'm sure my scores are lower than everybody else's if you were to look at it, but that meets expectations. That's satisfactory. That's not mediocre. That's what you're supposed to do. And I have high expectations. So to be a B above expected needs to be good. And I think you're doing very good in most things. So thank you, and I appreciate the work you're doing.
Additional comments on the what Mr. Stokes has presented as the superintendent's goals. Okay. Renee, were you able to do any calculations yet?
Mr. President, I know that there was no actual numbers associated with the superior, if you will. And do you see how?
Four.
Okay. Okay.
Okay. But we didn't put that on our evaluation.
So
we should put
okay.
our number system
yeah,
in.
Yeah, I was going off of the numbers.
It should have.
So my apologies. Okay, just one moment.
If everybody can add up their own numbers.
Okay. Okay. Yeah, I wasn't aware that it was a 1-4. I was going off the numbers that were on the actual form, so my apologies. So thank you, Ms. Towns. So the way that it was calculated from 1-4s, and so the overall score would be, or rating, excuse me, would be 3.55.
That's the 34.55.
Excuse me, 34.55. I apologize again. And so that's the overall compilation of the everyone's scores.
Okay, based upon our rating, then that would be very satisfactory. Well,
we could
go. Are we rounding? We could round up, which would be the 34. We could go to 35, which would put him in the a rating of, or a rating of superior. And let's round up. Any objection to rounding up?
I move that the Carson City School District Board of Trustees deem the overall rating of Mr. Richard Stokes, superintendent of the Carson City School District, to be superior for the 2015 calendar year.
The motion, any second?
Second.
Motion and a second. Any discussion on the motion? Any public input? Seeing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Carries unanimously. Richard, keep up the good work. You've taken this district just a long ways. I know from the time, even before I was on the board, when you were thrust into this job, you know, you went through some difficult times, but you've stayed with it. And I will now, since the cheerleading incident was brought up, I commend you on the action you took. I thought it was very thoughtful, and the approach was something that I think all should be accepting. You know, that it is very difficult because there were parents and cheerleaders, but you gave both an avenue or a pathway to make things a whole lot better. So I thought you did a great job in that. Steve?
I'm surprised. I guess I'm not surprised anymore, but I've been impressed every time that I go to a NASB conference and get to talking to people from other districts, how much respect and deference that Richard has earned from those other districts and those other superintendents. They don't have to bring it up. Most of them don't say anything about other people, but again, however he has done it, he has earned a lot of respect on that state level for the things going on here. So.
Yeah, Joe.
I'll just reiterate what Steve said. I mean, when I talk to other folks in and out of the district, I always hear positive things about Mr. Stokes, and certainly when I talk about him, I hold him in pretty high regard. I think he's a good person. He's an exceptional person, and I think all in all, an exceptional superintendent. And sitting up here, you know, we are tasked with casting a vote. You know, and it's not an easy thing to do. It's, you know, none of us are perfect. We all have areas to improve. I've never met a perfect person. I'm looking for that person. But anyway, so I appreciate, I just wanted, aside from appreciating Mr. Stokes, I just appreciate, you know, everybody else sitting up here on the school board. Everybody has different opinions as to how we rate certain people on different things. And I think everybody had some good input. So thanks to Mr. Stokes and everybody.
And now we'll turn it over to Mr. Stokes. Comments?
Yes, thank you, Mr. President. Joe, Trustee Cassiopo, you won't find that perfect person because I married her. I hope that gives me some points when I get home. I want y'all to know how fortunate I feel to work here because this is just a great place to live and to work, and I think part of the benefits that I derive from my job is just the satisfaction of knowing that I'm surrounded by really terrific, talented people, and so having their professional relationship and having them contributing in a positive way is just. It's really a great place to work, and so I appreciate the feedback. I'd also say that, you know, feedback doesn't have to happen just during evaluation time. I hope I've cultivated enough trust with you folks that you could come to me and that you would let me know if there's some area that you'd like to see, you know, done a little bit differently, and but. It's a great place to work. Just enjoy every day coming to work and rubbing shoulders with folks and enjoy what they do for me. We have great students, evidenced by tonight. Collectively, when I see their contributions to our school district, I feel validated, I guess, for the work that we do every day, but also know that our collective futures are in good hands as those kids come through and say what they say and show what they do. So again, I thank you. I appreciate your support. I know that we have great things yet to accomplish and that we will always have work to do. That's true with any condition of human nature. And again, I want to thank my staff. These guys are just terrific. Renee, thanks every day for all. and to you folks, I know your jobs are tough too, and I appreciate your skill and your just the life experience that you bring to the board. I think that's critical, and it's a nice representative of our community. So, again, thank you. Appreciate your support.
Good job, Richard. Thank you. Okay, we'll now move on to the approval of the consent agenda.
I move that the Carson City School District Board of Trustees approve the consent agenda as submitted.
Joe seconded. Before you do that, any comments from the public? Okay, well, we got two. Okay, seeing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Agenda item number 15, informational item. Any comments, activities, or items of interest on the information agenda item?
I'd just like to say, thank you. I always appreciate these summary lists. So Richard, Renee, whoever's involved in this, thank you.
And I'll just make one comment. The STEM Summit night, Wednesday, December 9th, it's 6 o'clock. And I see Alan still here. I mean, we got great people like Alan and Amy and all these people. We should showcase them now. And you talk about positives. Let's be there to support them.
And will that be agenda or posted? It doesn't have to be posted. We can all still come. Okay.
Okay. Agenda item 16, request for a future agenda. Topics?
Just a thought, because January 2016 is coming up and our strategic plan goes through 2017, and I don't want to throw it out there now, but at some point during the year 2016, should we look at reconvening and getting a strategic plan to follow after that year?
Yes, good point. Okay.
It's perfect after that. Let's put it away.
Okay, then any other future? I have one, and I talked to Mr. Stokes about this, the first meeting in January. You know, and I think the board would like to know what steps have been taken and are currently being taken for all of those students who are going to be taking the ACT. And Tasha apparently is going to be March 1st. So there should have been something already, you know, steps taken, but we have 8 weeks after the first of the year to prepare students. And we all know that some were not intending to take it or didn't intend to go to college. But it's now a state law, and there are learning standards in there, and it's an opportunity to give these kids one more boost of going back in English and math and science and giving them, you know, a reason. It's not just for the sake of taking a test. It's things that are used in life. So on that agenda item, what steps are being taken to get to each? How many of the kids are going to be taking that, and what steps are taken to get to each individual one of those kids?